So if there are some stragglers, just make it up to the front and get nice and close.
Closer! Closer! I love you! Hey! Wow. I heard it.
But don't cross the line. Okay. First, I'd like to acknowledge that we are on Treaty 6 territory, a traditional meeting grounds, gathering place, and traveling route to the Cree, Soto, Blackfoot, Métis, Dene, and Nakota still. We acknowledge all the many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit, whose footsteps have marked these lands for centuries. Also, I'd like to acknowledge the fact that I have never organized anything like this before. The most that I've done is stood slapdog in the crowd and cheered when everyone else does. So this is probably not going to be your typical rally. I'm a pretty melancholy human, so y'all are going to have to rally yourselves up. I didn't want this to be a big hurrah towards heroic anti-racist rhetoric. I want this to be about self-reflection. Boring, I know, but also necessary. We're going to talk about the history of Frank Oliver and the effects of his legacy on people of color and Indigenous people in our city. We're also going to address the broader topics of systematic racism. But first, we need to talk about the thing that makes so many of us incredibly uncomfortable. We need to talk about whiteness. Before we do that, let's all take a deep breath, let go of our posture of defensiveness, and instead embrace a posture of humility. Because that's what it takes to conquer white supremacy. At the base of it, it's humility. It's not just love or anger, although those are part of it. It's not just unity or niceness. It's certainly not guilt. That's not what is being asked of us. If we want to fight this thing, we need humility. So let's breathe. Okay. Whiteness is an identity. It's a part of my identity, and I want to address those of you who share that identity with me. I want to start off by saying your experience matters. You may experience pain that other people, no matter their race or identity, could never imagine. What we're trying to say is that you didn't experience that pain because you are white. Whiteness has not obstructed you or caused difficulty for you. You may experience pain and hardship, but you aren't experiencing that pain and hardship because black people don't trust your work. You aren't having a hard time getting ahead because Muslims don't like the way your name sounds on a resume. So what is whiteness? We often look at whiteness as this invisible thing that decides what is normal in our culture, whereas all other races are completely visible because they are not us. To us, it seems that everything outside of whiteness is other. It's tangible to us. Something we can point out in clothing or way of speaking. We don't think that people of other races look at us with that same tangibility. We're so used to the way we dress or speak or act as being the norm that we aren't able to comprehend that this is part of our identity. Being viewed white means that we're held accountable not as individuals, but as a part of a group within a larger society. In other words, we, white people, are not the society, but a part of the society. Yes, you are an individual who prescribes to personal beliefs that you believe affect only you, but when you are part of a group, your beliefs, actions, and decisions affect the way that group thinks. And unfortunately, white people as a group have always held power over other groups. So what we think affects not only ourselves, but also our group, which in turn affects all other groups of people. The term white was invented back in 1690 to determine who would be allowed to own land, vote, and own slaves in what would later be the United States. White was literally an identity invented to determine who got to hold power and who didn't. White was never a race. It was never about skin. Whiteness was always based in oppression. So the explanation for why we struggle to understand our impact in systematic racism comes from the lack of knowledge of what race even means. If we can't identify why whiteness gives us privilege, we aren't going to be able to understand that we're hoarding that privilege. We hoard it because we have been taught that we deserve it, that we earned it and worked hard for it. Think about that. We know that the majority of people below the poverty line in our country are Indigenous people and people of color. That's a fact. So is the issue that most Indigenous people or people of color simply don't work as hard as white people? Are Black and Indigenous people more likely to be carded because they are more likely to be criminals? More likely to be violent? The data on carding is certainly pointing to this. Or are our justice systems holding on to a bias that has long been held in our history? What about in schools? What's happening in our school systems when non-white kids are more likely to be screened than white kids? Are they intellectually lower than us? Or are our white school systems wearing them down? We simply have never been taught the way in which history rewards whiteness and punishes non-white people. That history has gone unquestioned and unchallenged. We've swept it away. So while some of us as individuals may have moved ahead in our understanding that skin color doesn't determine whether someone should have freedom and rights, our systems have not, because they were never about skin, but power. White allies, accomplices, progressives, liberals, you name it, whatever you identify yourself as, we can't be set apart from our whiteness. Not even when we see it, not even when we understand it. So what do we do with it? Well, guilt for one is completely useless. It's not an effective motivator. We need to stop feeling guilty for our whiteness. We did not choose whiteness, yet we continue to benefit from it. Equality is not limited in quantity. We can all have it, but that means that power must be distributed equally. It means that white folks are overrepresented in places of power. This doesn't just apply on government levels or in our workplaces. This applies in activist circles. Look at your organizations. Who's running them? Why are they running it? How likely is it that the non-white people in your organization will have their voices heard and their ideas taken seriously? Where does the money go, and who decides where it goes? If a non-white woman were in charge, would the money be handled differently? Are you creating space for racialized people to use their experiences to change the structures, or are you creating space for the sake of diversity? In anti-racism activism, people of color able to speak or talk publicly without fear of being punished when work reaches their workplace? Many of the people I know through Black Lives Matter aren't able to put it on their resume because of the repercussions that representing Black resistance has. Look at your circles and question them. Why haven't things progressed? The most important question is, who are you afraid to offend? If you aren't willing to make changes that will benefit marginalized people because you're afraid to lose the trust and backing of white people, you must understand that you have built your organization on white supremacy. Until you change that, nothing will change. White people, listen. We need to give up our platforms so that those with the knowledge of what oppression really looks and feels like can start to deconstruct the systems meant to keep them down. It's simply a matter of experience. We lack the experience needed to change the systems at play. We don't have a clue what systematic racism feels like, so why aren't we asking those who are experiencing it to show us what it should look like? Perhaps it's because we're so used to holding that power, and maybe we really aren't ready to give it up. Perhaps it's because we haven't even bothered to notice that we're holding. Connor was raising the stories and